Hey, I'm Darius, and I'm a developer community engineer at Mux. And we migrated 50,000 lines of code to React server components. And I'm here to tell you that it's possible and not that scary and probably worth it. More specifically, I want to tell you what we moved to server components, how you can migrate your own code, and some advanced patterns you can use along the way. I'm hoping this talk will be helpful for folks who are already familiar with React server components and are trying to understand what a migration looks like. If you want to learn more about the fundamentals, I'm sure we have some amazing talks at the conference. I also have a blog post you can find on mux.com that's almost as good as Josh Camo's. In the past year, both our documentation website and our marketing website underwent some foundational changes. The documentation site saw an information hierarchy rethink, and our marketing website was entirely rebranded. Since these projects were under the hood anyway, we realized we had an opportunity to move to React Server Components and the App Directory. For us, the benefits were clear. The App Router offered its powerful layouts paradigm that meshed well with our new information architecture. And across the board, we saw how React Server Components could reduce our bundle size, improve perceptual performance with streaming, and allow us to localize data fetching with individual components. But if those are the benefits, what are the costs? How much work did it take to migrate 50,000 lines of code to React Server Components? Honestly, with the right patterns, not that much. Let's talk about those patterns. I know it's easy to feel overwhelmed by React Server Components. Believe me, we were there too. But I think our three-step program can help with that. Here's how it looks. First, add the use client directive to the root of each page. Next, move the directive as low in the rendering tree as you can. And finally, if performance issues arise, adopt advanced patterns. Let's take a look at a few examples. So let's say you're following the App Router incremental adoption guide. You have a simple page here in the Pages router, and following the instructions, you move it up to the App Router, rename it to page.tsx, and yeah. The first thing you'll notice is we've got an error. This error happens because, by default, everything imported in the App Router is a server component, and server components don't have access to client functionality like useEffect. Let's get rid of that error by adding useClient to the root of this page, and the error is gone. But what happens if you have server-side data fetching in, for example, getStaticProps? You can't do that on the client. So let's do this slightly differently. When we move this route up to the App Router, let's move it just as a client component. And then let's import that component in page.tsx. Page.tsx is running on the server, so we can just directly fetch data there. Cool. There's more to an App Directory migration than just server components. Some routing hooks, how metadata works, just to name a few. But since we're focused on server components in this talk, I'll encourage you to check out the official migration guide for that story. This part's not too bad, I promise. It's just normal programming. Follow the errors, take them down one by one. I know it's hard to believe, but the most difficult part is done. For step two, we're going to take that use client directive from the root of our page and push it down into each individual component. Let's try that now. We're going to take it out of the file, move it into player, move it into title. Looks like our application still works. Let's repeat the process one more time. Since player has no children, we're just going to remove the directive. Same goes for title. Oh, yeah, an error in player. Let's put the directive back there. Okay, looks like everything's working again. Guess what? You're done. You've moved to Next 13, you've moved your functionality to React Server Components, you've reduced your bundle size by shipping less to the client, and now all of your future work can be done with React Server Components in mind. Bye all! No, just kidding. We've still got like 5 minutes left. You could leave it here, but you and I both know that server components can do so much more than that. So let's move on to step three. If you notice a place in your app that's slow, maybe from a big bundle or a slow data call, then leaning into more advanced server component features might be for you. For example, when we migrated our docs, we leaned on two patterns to unlock deeper gains. The first was wrapping key server components in suspense to enable streaming of slow data fetches. Our whole app is statically generated, except for the changelog, which comes from a CMS. And since the sidebar requires changelog data, the sidebar layout has to wait for the CMS. By wrapping that sidebar in suspense, the rest of the app doesn't have to wait anymore. The second optimization we applied was creatively rearranging client and server components to ensure that large libraries, like our syntax highlighter Prism, stayed on the server. And speaking of creatively rearranging client and server components, let's talk about some advanced patterns that you can take home and use in your own app. Starting with unsupported libraries. You're going to run into this a lot. In fact, if you were paying attention, we already have with our player component like 3 minutes ago. But I'm going to go over it again here since it covers some useful fundamentals. Trying to use a library that's unsupported, you'll probably get this error. All you need to do is wrap it and put a use client into the wrapper. And it works. But let's remember why this works. Everything imported by a client component is a client component. That's so important, so let me say it again.
Everything imported by a client component is also a client component.
It's also shipped to the client. Why am I repeating this so much? Well, let's go on to the biggest advanced pattern. What happens if you want to mix client and server components? Take, for example, these tabs. You need client functionality to switch between the tabs to respond to the clicks and so on. But there's no need to render all these children on the client too, right? Why are we shipping all that if it's just static? But that's exactly what would happen if you did this the obvious way. Here, we're importing password and account in our client component. When we do this, password and account, despite being static content, are still rendered on the client. So if we're not allowed to import server content in client components, how do we work around this? Well, what if we imported that content from a server component instead and passed it as a prop to the client component? Because it's imported in a server context instead of a client context, it stays on the server. Put another way, it's owned by another server component. You'll sometimes hear this called the ownership tree. If it's helpful, you can think of it this way. Use client is telling your bundler that this is the client server boundary. If that's not helpful, well, ignore the last sentence. Since we've got some time left, one last pattern. What if I want half of my component to stay on the server and the other half to be shipped to the client? This is a pattern we've used in places like our code block. We want our syntax highlighter to stay on the server since it's a big bundle, but we want some client-side interactivity, like a copy button. Well, let's split up this code block into two files. We've got codeblock.server and codeblock.client. They don't have to be called that, it just helps keep it straight. Here's what the server component looks like, and the server component imports the client component, passes the server content as children. And finally, so that consumers don't have to worry about implementation, we'll use the barrel file pattern, which uses an index.ts file to re-export the default export of the server component, so that if any consumers want to consume the component, all they need to do is import code block from the folder directly. And that's migration and advanced patterns. To learn more about our patterns and our own migration, check out the full blog post at mux.com. I feel like we still haven't answered the key question here, though. Should you migrate to React server components? Honestly, I don't have a great answer. I know why we migrated. We migrated because of layouts, because of streaming, because of bundle size, and because it feels like the future of React. But right now, as you can tell from our advanced patterns, the flexibility of React server components does come with complexity. If you choose to proceed with a migration, hopefully these patterns make you feel empowered to keep that complexity under control. That's all for me. Happy coding.